विश्वजीत बासु सर, करेंटली चेयरपर्सन ऑफ द बंगाल एकेडमी ऑफ अप्लाइड होम्योपैथी, लाइफ मेंबर ऑफ हमाए एंड द फैकल्टी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मटीरिया मेडिका एंड ऑल्सो डी एन डी होम्योपैथिक मेडिकल कॉलेज एंड हॉस्पिटल कलकत्ता, नॉमिनेटेड फैकल्टी मेंटर एंड गाइड फॉर हनीमैन कॉलेज ऑफ होम्योपैथी लंदन. He is practicing homeopathy for about last 30 years and is a renowned practitioner of homeopathy. And he has presented papers in many national and international conferences, of Liga conferences also, and authored 3 books, namely Family History, an illustration on the family history, an expedition on carcinogen, and an exposition on thyroidin.
Namaskar. Good evening to everybody. At the outset, I pay my gratitude and thanks to the organizer for giving me the opportunity to share my views. Today's topic is scope of research in accordance with homeopathic principles. First of all, I do like to quote from our master what he said: "No science, no art, even no craft has progressed so little with the march of time. No science has remained so far behind in its original imperfection as the science of medicine. Our medical science requires a complete reformation from head to foot. The process of reformation started in the hands of Hahnemann. We are supposed to still like to reform from head to foot the medical science with the help of homeopathic principles." Now I am taking the privilege to quote from one of the great lover of homeopathy in our country, Nobel laureate Rabindranath Tagore, what he said: "It is not merely a collection of few medicine, but a new science with a rational philosophy as its base. We require more scientific interest." What he said: "We require more scientific interest, the story rather the fact." One of the great stalwarts, it could be better say the Hahnemann of India, Dr. Manohar Sarkar. In the year 1902, July, regarding conversion to homeopathy, he was even a very famous allopathic physician, an MD from Calcutta University. What he wrote, what was his experience? That is the starting point of homeopathic research in our country. Before taking this step, what is the step? For conversion from allopathic doctor to homeopathic doctor. Before taking this step, I made a stipulation with Babu Rajendra. I told him that as I believed his cures are effected by the strict regimen that he enjoined and not by his infinitesimal nothings, globules or drops, I would agree to observe cases with him provided he agreed to keep the patients for a time at least under the strict regimen alone and give them no medicine till it should appear that further expectancy would be injurious. What actually we are telling about the exclusion criteria in homeopathic or any research. He readily agreed. Strange to say, and to his dismay, few cases did recover under regimen alone and without any medicine. But my triumph was not to continue long, for others proved refractory and I had to give my consent to administer his medicine to them. A great many recovered and incurables are benefited. This fact staggered me. The efficacy was too evident to be gainsaid. Actually, what was the observation and research protocol? They have observed simple. They have took some patients with regimen and another group with medicine and regimen, like any control trial method. They have conducted research and getting the output of that research work, great man Dr. Manohar Sarkar converted himself from allopathy to homeopathy. Now I am going to my topics. According to World Health Organization, what is research methodology? Research methodology is a systemic body of procedures and technique applied in carrying out our investigation of experimentation targeted at obtaining new knowledge. And what is research? Research is nothing but an organized study. It is a methodical investigation into a subject in order to discover facts, to establish or revise a theory, to develop a plan of action based on the facts discovered. There are three things. Through research we may discover facts, through research we may establish or revise a theory, or through research we may make a plan of action based on facts discovered. Now I am telling about the rationale of research in homeopathy. Today's world demands evidence, you all know. Homeopathy is offering evidence through clinics, and credibility increases day by day. But skeptics are taking advantage of so-called deficiency of homeopathic science. Rather, it could be better if we say it is a deficiency of basic science to explain homeopathy, such as lacking of credible scientific explanation to explain its mechanism of action, and also deny the component and quality in potentized homeopathic medicine. Thus, conducting research has become an inevitable part. Would be better if it be interdisciplinary. Now I am telling the stages of research. The first, thinking about it. Second, preparing for the proposal and hypothesis. Third, conducting the research. Fourth, writing the research paper. Fifth, sharing the research outcome. And sixth, revising the research paper. Actually, my today's discussion will be confined from stage 1 and 2 in elaborate, and then precursor of stage 3. We all know the three tenets of homeopathy can become objects of scientific investigation. What are the three tenets? Law of similia, homeopathic potentized medicine, and individualistic approach. From these three tenets of homeopathic aspects, I do like to discuss the scope of research in homeopathic field. First tenet is law of similia. In law of similia, what is done by Hahnemann himself? He experimented in his lifetime. Hahnemann took 4 drams of China twice a day, had paroxysm of chill and fever. In his practice, he had seen similar paroxysm of chill and fever. What he observed? After getting China, they recovered and cured. And what was the inference? Peruvian cork cures paroxysm of chill and fever because it produces paroxysm of chill and fever. So he concluded in that manner, disease producing power of the medicine is disease curing power. The next point we may like to highlight, through law of similia, healing is achieved by taking a drug that proved by healthy individuals have yielded symptoms and signs very similar to those of the patient. So we have to match conceptual image of the medicine with conceptual image of the disease. In that perspective, we should divide in 2 parts, law of similia and the scope of research. First part, disease producing power. In the perspective of disease producing power, what are the sources, what are the scope of research in homeopathy? First is human pathogenetic trial, knowledge of curative power of medicine through drug proving. We all know in our country, Central Council of Research in Homeopathy, they are conducting drug proving for a long time, double-blind, randomized, placebo-controlled trials. Through human pathogenetic trial, what research we can conduct, whether homeopathic medicine is placebo or not, through this trial we can prove it. Apart from that, whenever the prover, the healthy subjects, they are taking homeopathic medicine in defined dose and potency, we may study the immunological status of those subjects who are proving medicine, and the immunomodulatory effect of homeopathic medicine can be studied during human pathogenetic trials. Apart from that, study of physiological parameters before and after proving. The most important thing, we have to reprove old medicine and revalidate the sphere of action of the drug in respect of recent scenario of innumerable diseases. Now I am telling the second part of law of similia, that is disease curing power of the medicine. Just before I have discussed about disease producing power, now having the scope in the perspective of disease curing power of the medicine, that is clinical trial on six subjects. First of all, what can I do? Evidence-based case presentation. Simple evidence-based case presentation. Apart from that, to prove efficacy of homeopathic medicines after administration according to law of similia. In this field also, we can prove homeopathic medicine is not placebo. What Dr. Manohar Sarkar did at the starting point in his practice. Then importance of dose and potency. Another important point from clinical trial on six subjects, what we got and we do conduct research, effectiveness of homeopathic medicine in comparison with other system of medicine on any defined clinical condition. Effectiveness of homeopathic medicine, suppose we are considering, we do like to explore the effectiveness of homeopathic medicine in bronchial asthma. So we have to conduct a research, clinical trial on six subjects, those who are suffering from bronchial asthma. Then getting the analyzed data, we may compare it with the bronchial asthma patient, those who are suffered and treated by other system of medicine. With the help of economists, with the help of social science persons, study of socioeconomic aspects of homeopathic medicine, that is, whether it is cost effective or not, that also can be studied in the part of clinical trial on six subjects. Now I am coming to the second point of three tenets of homeopathy, the dilution and dynamization. In homeopathy, diluted and dynamized drugs are being used. Dilution followed by succussion, trituration increases the potency of the drug. Then what is the scope in that field, in dilution and dynamization? Mostly the scope is interdisciplinary. First, existence of drug, component and quality of medicine, and its demonstration in terms of language of science. With the help of electronics, electrical, or any recent advances in the field of basic science, nanoscience, etc. Professor Mahato's paper, beautifully discussed by Shumon. In that paper, what he have discussed, it is under the heading of dilution and dynamization in our principle. Based on Avogadro's number, any potency of homeopathic medicine beyond 12C cannot contain any trace of its material form. Skeptics are taking this advantage of this deficiency and always highlighting. But actually, this is not the deficiency of homeopathic science. This is the disadvantage, this is the advantage they are taking, deficiency of basic science, not to demonstrate homeopathic potency. But through advanced scientific support, dissipative structure of homeopathic medicine validated by quantum electrodynamics, Mahato sir report has shifted the focus of chemical formula to physical structure and set aside the materialistic obsession that every medicine must have its own chemistry. Now I am taking also the privilege and honor regarding dilution and dynamization in biology. In vitro, outside living organism, or in vivo, effect on living animal, cell line, etc. Experiment with potentized medicine to explore how it works in biology, interdisciplinary work with the help of biological sciences. In that regard, I am happy to share information. The effect of homeopathic medicine in Japanese encephalitis is being conducted at Tropical School of Medicine, Kolkata, in collaboration with CCRIs about 10 years ago. They conducted work in vitro and vivo about the efficacy of homeopathic medicine in potentized form. Belladonna in 200 form and 6 different form they have given, but it found Belladonna 200 was more effective in vitro and vivo when they are conducting research. So these are the fields from the principle of dilution and dynamization, what can we do? Then interdisciplinary work may be conducted at any dedicated medical research institute to establish the mechanism of action, place of action, the way of action, with the help of molecular biologists and many more. Now, last but not the least, the three tenets of homeopathy individualization, that is, last point is individualization. Homeopathic approach is best appreciated as personalized, individualistic approach is a holistic method of diagnosis of the patient that has the disease. Diagnosis of the patient that has the disease and prescription to be done according to principles. So from individualization perspective, what research we can conduct? First, formal case study for individual case. And in order to establish and promote homeopathic system of medicine, study to establish effect of any particular medicine with therapeutic goal and nomenclature of disease not to be indulged. Most of the dissertation paper is being conducted in different homeopathic postgraduate colleges. Effect of a particular medicine on any particular disease. Suppose effect of thuja on hemorrhoids, effect of cantharis in urinary tract infection. I do like to say this type of research work is not at par homeopathic principle in the perspective of individualistic point of view. These works must not be indulged. These work actually satisfy principle and methods of other system of medicine, but not homeopathy. So what can I do? What can we conduct? For any given clinical condition, medicine should be selected according to principle. From individualistic perspective, considering the totality of the symptom, that would encompass exciting or fundamental cause of the disease and effect of the cause, that is the morbid phenomena. So different medicine may yield good and curative effect for a particular clinical stage in different person. That should be analyzed, that should be formulated as efficacy and also be compared with other system of medicine. Now I am concluding my lecture. In homeopathic research, first of all, we have to identify, define the problem in the perspective of homeopathic principle, either from law of similia or from dilution or potentization or from individualistic approach. Next, the review of literature from different sources. Then we have to formulate aims and objectives. Then formulation of proposal and hypothesis. Then designing research, then conducting the research, collection of data, statistical analysis and interpretation of data, and ultimately publication of result. These should be the steps we should follow during homeopathic research. But the things we should remember, we should keep in mind, whatever research we do like to conduct in homeopathic field, that should be in the perspective of law of similia, theory of dynamization, and theory of individualization. Thank all of you. Last of all, I do like once again quote from Hahnemann, what he said, "I am not ashamed to confess that did not know yesterday what experiences might teach me today." If Hahnemann did not ashamed, we are not supposed to be ashamed what did not know yesterday, what experience might teach me today. From this aspiration, I would like to thank all of you once again, the organizer, especially Dr. Suman Haldar and his team, entire team, to give me the opportunity to share my views with the eminent panelist. Thank all of you for patience hearing.